So. Yeah, I think we are live now. Hello,
Okay.
everyone.
Hi.
Hi, Lukas.
Good afternoon.
Yes.
Okay.
Depending where are you in the on which part of the world, good morning, good evening, or good afternoon. Hopefully not good night.
No.
But I can imagine in a very far Asian part, maybe some people already are preparing to sleep. But then stay for 1.5 hours with us. Learn a couple of new stuff about
Content
content
knowledge.
management systems today on the Jekyll stack. Not Jekyll stack, sorry, Gem stack.
Jamstack, yeah. Some of these CMS systems are actually solely based for on Jekyll and not for other static site generators, but some are very flexible. So yeah. And this event is going to be a bit like last week where we discussed more and didn't do a lot of live coding
It's live
because,
discussing, right?
yeah, live discussing without much of preparation. And I only have opened like 20 tabs in my in Chrome, so I have some points where I can look up, yeah, some links are prepared and I will show that later, yeah.
Yeah. By the way, at the end of this session, we will have a raffle with one winner, and the prize for the raffle will be one personal JetBrains IDE license. JetBrains is a Czech company, meanwhile, or the international company, but with a headquarters in Czech Republic. And they develop very cool, among other things, they develop very cool IDEs for different programming languages. And the most popular one, the most popular one, Lucas?
I think either IntelliJ or how is the web IDE called? I
Yeah,
forgot.
WebStorm,
Yeah.
probably, right? But I
There
think
are,
IntelliJ is probably the most popular one,
yeah, or
at least the most.
if you include Android Studio, which is also based on IntelliJ's IDEs.
Oh,
Yeah.
yeah.
Yeah, and also they have the programming language Kotlin, which is very popular for
It's
Android development.
partially curated by them and partially by Google, right?
Yeah, I think Google didn't intend to develop another language for the Java virtual machine, but they started it so and then many developers adopted it, and so Google had to kind of get on this train, yeah.
Okay, very cool. Yeah, and with this personal license, you will be able to get just get any IDE from their portfolio, which is like really nice. But we will have it at the end of
For
this
how
week.
long is
I
it?
at least for 1 year. I think
Oh,
for 1 year. Yeah, for
it's
one
really
year.
good if you look at their pricing, it's
Yeah, it's
not very
worth
cheap.
several hundreds of dollars.
Yeah, but it's not really, it doesn't really have to do something with our session today, but it's definitely a very nice gift. So even
Yeah.
if you, yeah, even if you aren't interested in content management, you should keep listening.
Yes. And we will try to keep it coming in other sessions as well. Maybe we will have different prizes for different raffles. Let's see. But yeah, this one will be really nice. Whoever will get it.
Okay, then maybe let's jump just in right into our topic.
Yes.
Yeah, in our earlier sessions, we started developing our community homepage for cloudstudy.net, and we did that using a very modern development approach, and that is called Jamstack, JAM stack. Yeah. It's basically contrary to older approaches that are called like monolithic web applications or dynamic web applications, which are some popular programs are, for example, WordPress or Drupal.
And these are classical content management systems, right? Which you just mentioned. Actually, WordPress, it started not as a content management, just a blogging platform, but then it kind of became a content management system.
Yeah, and people started using it for even bigger projects, which is kind of somehow at some sites look strange, some big sites, and aren't very performant. So there is an alternative, and it's called Jamstack, which is basically that you use a static site generator, which builds your website, and then you have a separated content management system and microservices that you can access via an API from your website, instead of having all on one web server like you have with PHP and WordPress, for example.
Sounds great.
I could maybe, let's maybe draw what we had last week again on the screen. Like I do a small diagram.
Yeah, you want to program a plan again, like last time, right?
Yeah, just
because one participant asked us if this code which you wrote can be executed or something like this. It was funny.
No, I'm just writing
your notes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's. I'm too. Yeah, I cannot draw good with my mouse on the computer, so I use my IDE for doing that, because I don't have much else installed. Let me just. I want to share a screen. Just my IDE. Yeah. We had a static site generator, and then you have a content delivery network where you publish to a content delivery network.
Yeah, this is what we covered last time. If you are into content delivery networks, which can be used within the Jamstack, make sure to watch our session of the last week. It was also on Saturday last week. We covered very nicely all this CDN options which are available for the Jamstack.
Oh, sorry, did I stop presenting, or can you still?
We can see your screen.
Okay. Nice, yeah. Okay, last week we talked about the content delivery networks. That is basically what comes out of your static site generator. And in the earlier sessions, we talked what you feed into the static site generator that gets then compiled to the finished website and then gets delivered to the content delivery network. And what we had there was first the content and your layouts or theme. And today we are going, normally, if you feed this content into a static site generator, it's structured data, which is JSON, YAML, Markdown, maybe even already HTML, XML, all those formats that are very intuitive or very well known for developers, but not for the common user or many content editors. because they code, they just think English or their natural language. Yeah. And they, you can't expect them to write fully, to write good content with Markdown, HTML or JSON, for example. So the solution is to provide a content management system
Lucas, one question here in between from Pratik Jain. If it's possible to host this kind of websites or content for free.
What was the question again? If it is possible to
host this kind of websites or content for free. This is how I understood it, because the question like literally says, can we host this for free?
This is basically all what we covered last week, which is there are, for example, there is GitHub Pages, Netlify, which has a very good free tier, or not a tier, but basically a free plan that is unlimited of time. Yeah. What else? You can use, for example, Firebase hosting.
Quick Labs is also there, and a couple of more providers. But basically, whenever you deal with this static type of websites and the sites built on the Jamstack, there are many, many, many free options.
Yeah.
Because it's also very cheap for operators to run them, actually.
Yeah. Most of the providers like Firebase, or you can also run it on AWS S3 or Google Cloud Storage Plus. What was the service again? CloudFront.
Yes.
Amazon and get a new line. Google Cloud Storage Plus CDN. And there you can run it. And they have like a traffic limit you will never reach with your personal blog. Instead,
you cannot get it down, basically.
Yeah.
That's
the one thing.
Yes.
Your servers will never be down, but if you have like 5,000 users per month, you literally pay nothing. I have a website that has like 30,000 users per month, and we pay like, what is it? I think something like 30 cents, euro cents, which is nothing.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. That was a quick recap on content delivery networks and how to host it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then again to our topic. The content you feed into static site generators is structured data, meaning JSON, Markdown, HTML, XML, things like that. You can't expect non-developers, non-technical people to write this kind of data. So what you do is you connect it with a content management system. So, okay. And let's start new. Then let's talk more about the content management systems. You have basically different types of the CMS you can use for it. There are some that are called headless CMS. And there are Git-based CMS. And we talked in the earlier sessions about that many content, that mostly the content for static sites is stored in a Git repository where you have all your theme data and all your contents as Markdown and JSON and so on. And for example, as we have it with our community site, it is on GitHub. We have stored everything on of our website on GitHub. I can show you everything just as a recap.
Yeah. While searching, Lucas, maybe you can already answer one question, which is Jekyll both a content management system and a site static site generator? Is it both of it?
No, Jekyll is just the program that takes all of your structured data, content, and assets, and your layouts, the theme for your website, and compiles them together. And it,
yeah. So it's a generator only. It's only an SSG.
Yeah, it doesn't have anything included like a
no content management.
Yeah, like a content editor. It isn't included because it's just a program to build your site.
Mm-hmm. So the answer is it's just only an SSG, one of the most popular ones, but not really a content management system. It will fit pretty well for a few people, but if you have like a huge team, then either you have to manage this team via the GitHub process, or you have to get a content management, I guess, right?
Yeah, that is what we are going to talk today, because you have to use external content management systems. Okay, someone asked if there are any examples on Jekyll on Docker, which we are not going to cover today, but maybe in one of the following sessions, because we are definitely going to play around with some microservices that handle like dynamic features of our website in the future. And we are going to develop them on the basis of Docker, so we can maybe experiment with Jekyll on Docker.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I haven't used Jekyll on Docker myself, but maybe we could try to make a build process Docker, the build process Docker based. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then back to our topic. Yeah, we have a GitHub repository where everything of our site lays out and includes, which is basically our theme for the website. And then we have our content, which is for example here in posts. We have pages and we have authors and events. This is basically the content of our website, which is here Markdown files. Okay. Yeah, then I will just share my IDE again. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that is basically the basis what you need for a Git-based content management system. You have your Git repository on a hosted platform, mainly GitHub or GitLab, or in some CMS also work with Bitbucket. And every time you edit Sorry, telephone is. Let me just. I'll be back in a second.
No worries, okay? No worries. You can mute yourself and take time. Meanwhile, I will have a couple of announcements. Okay, everyone. So we have here, I just posted into the chat link to our actual repository where we built together with Lucas and everyone else. We are tinkering a little bit with the community website. It's not not ready yet, not done, but you can see the code. We are using it for this live coding sessions, which we do every single Saturday. And by the way, if we have our GitHub organization, it's called Cloud Community, and we have more than 300 people there as contributors, just, you know, members. And you know what? Feel free to join this organization at GitHub. You can make it public as well, this kind of membership there. It's in your settings somewhere. And it will just, you can then start contributing. We have a lot of repositories there, interesting stuff going on. I will be sharing for this, you know, you don't need much. You can just use this web link to create for yourself an invitation to our GitHub organization.
Yeah.
Let me share it with you. It's just an app at Heroku. You can go there. It's a web page, and you can enter your GitHub ID, your GitHub username, basically. It will create an invitation for you. So basically, it's a self-service. You can get it done in a matter of seconds, and you will be in.
Okay, it will automatically add the user to the.
It will create an invitation. So usually, if you have an organization at GitHub, you have to, as admin of this organization, as an owner, you have to invite people, and it's a manual job. Mm-hmm. I used to do it at the beginning, but you know, we have hundreds and hundreds of members, if not thousands. So it will be very tedious for me, like, to do everything, and then we have to wait for, you know, invitation and everything. So this app will allow you to create for yourself immediately an invitation for this organization, and then you can, from your GitHub account, you can immediately confirm that you are joining this organization, and that's it.
Currently, we are 329 people, which is really amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really a lot of people. I see very familiar faces, a lot of our members there, what is really amazing. We have also a lot of unconfirmed members. So basically, they were invited. We have like 64 unconfirmed yet. Mm. Maybe they are not using it as frequently, you know, the GitHub.
Yeah, or they just checking their webs, their email mailbox, their email inbox like twice a week, and so it's.
Yeah. By the way, in the description on the top, in the description of the organization, you will also find this link to this self-service to get invitation, you know.
Yeah, we have it here again.
Yes, exactly. So
yeah.
Basically, we are very open. Everyone can join, and we have a lot of repositories. Most of them, I have no idea what's going on there, because it was forked by our members. Probably they found something interesting. But we have also a curated repository of study guides for different certifications related to
cloud. I think this one, certification, yes, this one, exactly. Study guides. Yeah. Which is really great. We have everything as marked down here.
Yeah, but most of them are just placeholders. We are about to expand them. Our members can take initiative, and you know, whenever I study for some certification, some course, whatever, I do a lot of notes and everything, and then not just to keep it for myself, I would share it there, for example. And this is like how everyone can also do it. Hmm. We can jointly kind of contribute there.
And it will be open for everyone. Some people who have already contributed to it.
Yes. So. Another popular repository is a list of free certifications.
Yeah, which has already 122 stars, which is not, yeah. not bad.
The challenge is to keep it updated, you know, because like every week you will see that some of them would expire, something would change, you know. And the expired offers can be moved to this expired offers MD file. We are not just simply erasing them, you know.
Yeah, maybe we could try to integrate every, because we have on all of our these repositories, we already have markdown files which we could easily integrate into our websites.
Yeah, it would be great, actually.
So that would be really a great thing. Yeah.
Nice idea.
Yeah, for example. Okay, this sounds also interesting. Free books.
Yeah, but it's not a very big list. It's about, like, I don't know, less than 10 books which are legally available on the internet by their either authors or companies who are distributing them for free, so everyone can get them.
Yeah, because there are many websites which distribute them illegally, which isn't really great for the authors.
No, yeah, we cannot do this kind of stuff.
Yeah. Okay, again, do we want to move back to our topic today?
Absolutely.
Okay. Then, yeah, we have Git-based content management systems, which take a GitHub, GitLab, or Bitbucket repository, Bitbucket only in some cases. And they sync. They sync the content between the content management system and your GitHub repository or a Git repository. So every time you, for example, add an article to your blog, they are creating a commit under your name on the according Git provider. And yeah, it's really great. And yeah, they are creating markdown files that you can, that are simply integrated into your source on in the repository. Yeah, which is really great. And they just take the all of the configuration you have on in your, for example, if you're using Yugo or Jekyll, in this you already have a configuration file, and they are automatically taking this configuration for their CMS as of like the collections of content you have, like all site-wide configuration, like the title, URL, and assets, for example. Yeah. And this is one big thing, that these are content management systems that are also a little bit, or oftentimes a little bit limited to what they can do, because they are Git-based, and so they have to follow specific rules of the, or formats of content conventions of the static site generator they are using. For example, if you have Jekyll, you have to produce markdown files which have a YAML metadata header, or if you are using Yugo, the content management has to generate markdown files with the according Yugo templates and TOML header parts. Yeah. So the content management system has actually to support the static site generator that you want to use. Yeah, today we are going to look into three of those Git-based content management systems. One is Sitelive, one is Cloud Cannon, and they are very actively developing on the third option, which is Forestry. But beware, all of those content management systems can get quite cheap easily, and that is maybe a downside of it. So we are also looking into free content management systems today, but let's talk about it later. Maybe first, let's explain what a headless CMS is. Okay. Headless CMS are basically CMS that store all the content somewhere on a database in their system. You can't directly, your content isn't directly synchronized with your Git repository or something, or somewhere where your theme or something lays. It's separated from that. How you access your content is through an API, which is mostly REST or some cases also GraphQL. Okay, let's write REST or GraphQL based APIs, how you can access your content. Yeah. And to actually use them together with static site generators, you have to somehow connect them to your static site generator, because we talked about Jekyll, which uses Markdown, also YAML files, and I think JSON files. Okay, but what you get from the CMS is just the possibility to make some HTTP requests. So what you have to do is write somehow a program which fetches the data from this API, then, yeah, and somehow converts it to convert. Then you can, use your static site generator. Yeah, and this program to fetch the data and then convert it is oftentimes those content management systems, those headless content management systems support them. So they give you already built syncing programs for that. Yeah. Or connectors, how you want to call them, is, don't know. We're going to look into how's it called? Let me just Contentful. They all have very similar names. It's hard to remember all of them correctly, I think. Yeah. Yeah, basically Contentful, and later I will show you a list of many more content management system alternatives.
Interesting.
Once again, you have an or that too long didn't read you have a headless CMS exposes an API where you can fetch the data, then you have to convert it, that it follows the rules for the content of your static site generator, which is for Jekyll Markdown files or HTML files together with YAML and in some cases JSON. Yeah. Okay. Maybe I will simplify this.
But in the case, Lucas, in the case of headless CMS, how is the actual editor or user interacts with the system? Surely not via APIs, right?
Some of them also offer an API to edit the content, but in all those cases, they have a also for the Git-based CMS, is that you have a web application or a mobile app. I don't know if someone offers that, but in most cases, a web application where you can...
Yeah, it's just a web front-end with a text field where you can put rich text, right, and edit it.
Yeah, and some of them offer very some features on top of that. Most of them feature some kind of markdown editor, and what you see is what you get editor. And yeah, where you can just select text and then make it bold, italic, or insert a link easily instead of writing the source code for it. Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe we could look into some of the possibilities there are. Yeah. Okay, sorry. Yeah, I've mentioned Contentful. I haven't prepared a demo for it, but we can simply use Siteleaf, Forestry, and I think Cloud Cannon would work too. I don't know if they have a pricing, if you have to give them a credit card. Okay. Once again, someone asked if these CMS are offered as a software as a service, or if we have to host them ourselves. All of these solutions are software as a service.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you can't host them yourselves. But later I will show you some free alternatives that you have to host yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also interesting, like what kind of plans do they have if it's a SaaS system. So would be really great to have kind of beginner free tier, and then if you like go crazy and have very huge content in place, maybe then you can go pay.
Pricing actually gets crazy even if you don't have big sites. It's some of them are quite expensive.
Okay.
And yeah, I mean, we're talking about easily some $100 per year. Yeah,
but imagine you can run like the publishing house, right, using these tools, because it's so mighty with this Jamstack. You cannot get it down, you know.
Yeah.
And for businesses, this is great. For beginners, like would be really great to have a beginner plan. But we will get into it at some point, I think.
Yeah,
but it's kind of Lucas, you know, it's closing this whole loop. I think just 2 weeks ago we did have this kind of discussion with you, where I think I said like that this Jamstack is really nice because it's very reliable. Traffic-wise, it can handle like a lot of traffic. It's scalable and everything.
Yeah, and
but,
you can,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can replace every. Normally, you have one big system on a server with WordPress or something. And if you want to replace something, you have to replace everything you have. It's much more difficult to let's say, optimize your server or something. For Jamstack, you have everything broken down into very small pieces. You have a build process, which is a server like GitHub Actions or some service to build it. You have your source repository, which can be hosted anywhere nearly, GitLab, GitHub, Bitbucket. And you have your CDN, which you can replace anytime if you aren't happy with it, or if you want to if you want to be accessible in countries where your current provider isn't, yeah, you can also replace the content management as you desire, and that is really great. You can every part of this, of the website, yeah, building, publishing process is replaceable. So you are not fixed to one provider that you rely on. Yeah, with WordPress, for example, you have, if your server is down, you can't write content, you can't access your content on the internet, you can't do anything. Yeah, sorry for just bashing WordPress all the time, but this is the go-to example for me if I want to talk about dynamic websites.
Yeah, you can bash them. It's the most popular CMS in the world, so they can handle it, and it's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also WordPress also offers a headless API. You can also use it as a headless CMS and connect all static site generators to it. That's how I use it for some people who just don't want to, for some clients. Sorry, I shouldn't be talking too bad about them on a live stream, but yeah, they think WordPress is convenient. And yeah.
With many providers, you will get one-click installation of WordPress, you know.
Yeah.
And then it's really, like, usability-wise, I think it's not bad. And templates, there are, like, so many templates. I think, like, templates was one of the reasons why it became so popular, because there were so many beautiful templates from pretty much...
also plugins. You can easily install plugins, but... Then if you want to build very, very performant websites where you have, I always see those people who complain about their page loading speed. Then I look into the source code. You have 30 style sheets, all from different WordPress plugins, and 30 JavaScript files, also from different WordPress plugins. And that's the downside. You can install it in one click or so, but it doesn't, it's just super big, everything is very bloated, and this doesn't happen if you build everything, or if you build it more for yourself, every part of your website. So this doesn't mean you have to write every line of code, but that you control more of the build process of your site, and that is possible with Jamstack. Yeah, or that is what I do with Jamstack.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Give me a second.
So, do you think we have to? It would make sense to have a look at one of this kind of content management systems, or should we still keep this discussion? About the different types of CMSs for Jamstack.
I wanted to continue with showing some different sorts of content management systems, definitely some of the Git based, and for the others we could just look at the pricing and compare features.
Yeah.
I will share my screen for that.
Mm. Sounds great.
Let me quickly drink a bit, because my tea is too hot.
Yeah, you can drink slowly as well if you want. It's okay.
Yeah. I will now share my whole screen. Yeah. Yeah, I have a lot of Chrome tabs open. Yeah, I should have cleaned up before, but didn't do it. Yeah. You can see my screen?
Yeah, we can see your session,
Yeah. Okay.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
Already on the. Yeah, this is Siteleaf. It's their marketing page, and yeah, develop with existing code, Jekyll, and sync with GitHub. Yeah. Yeah. They explained basically everything I already said, that you, that is easy for non-technical writers and so on. Yeah, and what they also offer is pretty reliable, pretty reliable deployment of your website, which you have to do manually, but you have a big fat button on their website or on the web app. Yeah. Yeah, let me just stop me screen presenting for a second, because I have to log in.
And
people to see my.
So are you using this Siteleaf, or
not that much for new projects anymore, but I have some. I have many projects already running on it, so I'm to migrate everything to other content management solutions, and for some it's sufficient and very stable. Yeah. And for most of the projects it's really good working, so I don't want to change it in near future. Yeah. I will just look in. Okay, again, I've just clicked on a big button that said create a new site. There we could create a site from scratch or connect an existing repository, which we are going to do.
Should the repository be empty?
No, you can use a repository that is housing a Jekyll site for it. Okay, I didn't mention it, but Siteleaf is only working for Jekyll. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes.
Okay, I will look. I have forked the on the cloud community website to my username, cloudstudy.net. Yeah, I've just selected this, my username, and then the repository I want to use, and then branch, so it should be the master branch. Then we are creating the site. Yeah, you see it is fetching all the contents from there.
Okay, so it's just getting the files into itself, and probably, yeah, let's see what will happen on the next step. Interesting.
Yeah. Now we are in our editor. See, we can here select our project, which I'm not going to do. But yeah, here, this is our bar. We can generate a preview or set up hosting. And yeah, but we want to use something different than Amazon S3 or FTP. Yeah, we are maybe going to deploy the site some other time when it is actually finished. Yeah. It's basically what you get. You have here all your content, then files, which is the assets of your site. You can upload files here. You can manage users. Yeah.
What's going on in the users? Like, is it like somehow related to what we have? We didn't have any users, right?
Users is all the people who can edit your or who can access.
Okay. This, it's CMS content. Users.
Yeah, CMS users, it's
well, it's only you basically as of now.
Yeah, you can see there is there are some different roles. Admin, which is kind of the same as owner, but owner can delete the site or change something more. But admin is there, who can also change the settings of the site. Then there is publisher. Then we have writer. Writer can just create files, but cannot publish them. Yeah, publisher can do that. Okay. Yeah, we have this kind of.
Yeah, and these users, they will even not necessarily show up on the website at the end, because in the output, they will be probably completely missing, because it's an internal kind of system of this CMS.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just switching to just sharing my Chrome tab, which works. Yeah. Okay, then let's dive into the content editing, or let's, before we dive into how we edit the content, actually, let's dive into the settings. There we see our site title, can set a time zone for our, if we want to use some dates on our site for events or something, that the date formatting works. This is our metadata description, which will show up in all of the, which will show in all of the pages on the site as a meta tag, which is when you use Google, you have the site title and then under it you have a description, which is this field. Yeah. Then base URL, URL, yeah, should be HTTPS. study.net. Edit this. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we'll save that quickly. Yeah, hosting, we could set that up. See, we have FTP, Rackspace, Cloud Files, AWS, S3, GitHub Pages, and we're going to let it be disabled. Yeah. Sync is just our repository on GitHub. Yeah. I think they only support GitHub. Siteleaf only supports GitHub to sync the to sync this the projects. Yeah. Yeah, then we could switch to another plan, but we have a 14-day trial, which is they actually, their plans work for every page independently. So if you are creating a new page, you always have this free trial, which you can you can, if you want, you could maybe, I haven't tried it myself, but you can, you could maybe remove the site after the 14 days every time and kind of sneak out of this and never.
Yeah, and automate it, Lucas, to make it like every 2 weeks, you know, automate this process. Yeah. Just kidding. But no, is there a free plan actually?
Yeah, but let's look into that later, okay? Yeah.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. It's, let's maybe let's compare all those CMS options in the regards of the pricing, okay. Yeah. Then again, let's dive into content, how we can edit it. Pages is basically something like our index file, or yeah, if we want to create an about page or something like this, which is not like grouped content. Group content is like authors, and yeah, group content is how I mentioned in the earlier sessions. You, when you group content, you call it collections with which have documents in it. Yeah. There we have our authors, which is Vlad, Lucas, and Karen. Yeah, I will go into one. Yeah, it's kind of, yeah, this is basically how it looks like. We have a title. I will set it. Then we have a content. This is the main content we can edit. We have a markdown editor where we can, yeah, we see all the markdown, but we can add specific things with links, for example, with the controls here. We can add a heading one and they will automatically add the symbols we need for that. But we also have a visual editor, which will create markdown as the output. Yeah.
Oh, hello, that's nice. World.
And we can make it bold. Yeah, but the bad thing about it is that this visual editor is like for 3 years or something in beta. So I don't know if they are changing anything or developing on it. Yeah, sorry that I can't write my last name.
But it's really interesting because you have also the features there to attach a picture. This way they will probably upload it automatically, you know.
Yeah, it works really good. You can see your existing uploads. There mm-hmm. are none for now, but you can also upload files. Yeah, like that. Works really well. You can add tags and categories, which, for example, you have to remember that I added open source enthusiast for now here in this document, and later I'm going to switch now to another document because I know open source enthusiast is also true for Karen. I will edit and we can see that we have auto completion now. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You see, we have an image here. And this is basically, this is a very cool feature that Siteleaf provides. And if you, for example, specify a field, this is some random name, we could like that, right? Something like this. It is a normal text field, but if we, let's say, add something like content to it, okay, this doesn't work. There are some reserved words which will transform it to a, what you see is what you get editor with all the controls here. Not this, yeah, rich text editor, not the string editor you normally have. Yeah. And if you want to do something else, let's say color, we get a color picker, which is really great. Or if they just search if the word color is in the name. So if we say call it primary color, it should also work. If we integrate something like has or is, then it should get to be a Boolean value. Is admin, let's call it this way. Then we all get a Boolean for our content. Yeah, and if we want to add an image or any other file, we have something like, let's just make the example GPG file. Because we have file in it, it should give us the file uploading prompt. Yeah, if we want to add a background image, it looks for image here, and then we also have this file picker. Okay, they have some reserved words for it that we can add, and then it gets the specific content type. Yeah. Are you still here?
We are here, yeah, Lucas.
Okay.
It's pretty impressive, I would say. But then, can you change the name of the field?
It has to do something with image or file if you want this file picker.
It looks like the name of it kind of these are types, field types. But then you would like to probably, like, for example, for the picture, you would write there like profile picture or user picture, yeah, or whatever.
It should integrate a word that is kind of associated with images, like image, picture should also work. Yeah. Something like this. They have described it somewhere in their documentation. Let's switch to there. Learn.siteleaf.com, which is also a great resource. I think it might be there. Default fields, metadata, smart field names. Okay. See?
Mm-hmm.
Smart field names. To get the most out of Siteleaf, you should know about the different smart field names. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
File pickers, auto completion, visual text editing. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, makes sense.
File fields, you have something like this.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I think they actually improved it. Mm. Yeah. Then you have those collection fields, which is also a really great thing. If you have a collection which is called authors, and then you add to another file the attribute author, you can select another. You can select. Yeah, I will just show it to you how it works,
mm-hmm,
because it's too difficult to describe it. Okay, we have here our collection authors. Yeah, now we have event. I will just create a new event, and then I will add the field author. Then we can select one of our existing authors in this collection, which is really great. Yeah. And for the naming, we are naming a singular version of our collection name. If it's called authors, we have to name it author.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You can also do that with, for example, events should also work.
Mm-hmm. Mm, nice.
Yeah.
Whoa.
This is really a great thing. For example, if you are just writing a blog post, want to add Karen as the author. We actually have done it already. Well, we can easily change it here, which is quite nice. And yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it looks great, actually.
Yeah, it's what I like about it is that it is really straightforward. You don't have to know much. For some users, I actually teach them a bit of Markdown because they are more productive with it instead of using a visual editor. Yeah, but yeah, should also work fine for most.
Mm-hmm.
And these metadata fields are really great. You can, what I didn't mention was you can for example, nest these meta fields. If you want to have an array or a list, let's make something that we call images. Then we convert it to an object. We have, or no, let's make it differently. Convert to list. Okay, and then we convert this to an object which has the image attribute and new value which has an alternative text attribute. Then we give it another attribute, maybe, or maybe it's sufficient. Yeah. Now if we want to let's call it image gallery. This is how we can create a list of a list of objects. Yeah, it's very, very flexible to create content with that. And if you want to kind of enforce that every blog post already and has an image gallery, if you create it, you have to do it in the Jekyll configuration, which is a bit more difficult, but we talked about it in an earlier session. Have to look here. We have our config.yaml file. Somehow you can do this in the in the Siteleaf content editor, but I prefer to do it here. You have in your Jekyll config, you have listed all your collections here, and you have defaults for your collection, which are fields, metadata fields that should be the standard, be in the files by default. For example, the permalink, a title, subtitle, and so on. Yeah, if we, for example, want to, I will just do this here. Let's create for every event, we want to create a gallery, which is a list that contains an image, which contains items that have an image and an alternative text, which is also our description. So let's try to save it and see if Siteleaf, where we are returning to now, has already synced. It didn't sync for now. Let's look why it didn't sync. Oh, it should have now. Let's go back here. Okay, a few seconds ago. And okay. Now if we create a new event, it has the gallery already defined and we can simply add new values to the gallery. Or new images in this case. Yeah, it's very easy to define also a scheme that content editors should follow. Yeah.
Nice. So basically, this tool, this Siteleaf, fetched all the structure of our Jekyll website, which we created in previous sessions. And you can expand the content based on this structure. But it seems like you can create your new collections and basically expand your structure as well.
Yeah,
you can change it.
You have your scheme, your content scheme, which is defined in the config.yaml in your Git repository. You can somehow change it also here. Let's see. We have collection settings where we can maybe add some metadata fields which are defaults. but for me it didn't work, so I just defined my scheme in the config.yaml file. Yeah. And yeah, this is basically what we get if we want to create a new event, which we can create here, or if we want to create a new file for a collection, I will create here. Okay. This is basically the scheme that we enforce, but you can also extend it with any metadata you want. Yeah. In some cases, you want to have extra data for specific files in your collection, and this gives you the possibility. And so it's kind of like a document database where you somehow have a scheme of what data should be in your documents, but you can also add specific data, metadata into your documents as you desire, as opposed to SQL where you have like a strict scheme and you can extend it. Here you can extend it however you want.
Imagine, Lucas, to have something like this amazing UI, which you can self-host and which will kind of deploy the content to your GitHub repository, and this way you will kind of run a productive system. And you can turn off whenever you don't need it anymore, like, you know, this instance of UI, and that's it.
Yeah, this one is a software as a service. Yes. You have a monthly fee.
Yeah.
But there are some alternatives that are free, but you have to host them yourself.
We have one question in the chat right now. Did you have to push that change to GitHub or merely edit it online?
Right now, what I'd done with my config YAML, I was too lazy to open my IDE. So I just used the online editor on GitHub. But normally I have cloned the repository locally and yeah, keep it in sync with GitHub. Yeah. And it's like, if I'm working with Sideleaf, it's like there is another contributor who always pushes into the repository, and so I have to pull the repository also sometimes to keep it in sync, because sometimes you make changes with Sideleaf. Yeah. Okay, then let's look into some other alternatives. Maybe just very quickly. I think the system is the same on all. You have your collections, your documents, and your scheme that you can extend for your content editors. Yeah.
And one of our members, Dibibis, actually went ahead and checked the free tier. And he writes that its developer sites are limited to 100 megabytes and 100 pages, including posts and documents.
Yeah, let's try to cover all the pricing later, because let's just show some other alternatives and how they look, because Sideleaf is, I use it because it's so super intuitive and the setup is very simple for most of the users. Yeah. Okay, I will just share my screen again. Yeah, we've covered Sideleaf. Let's go to sideleaf.com again. That is basically what we had. Now, what else is there? Forestry, which is a bit more flexible because it doesn't only support Jekyll, but a lot of other static site generators. It's actually a newer company. They started later than Sideleaf, but yeah, they are really committed to this and build a great product. Yeah, it works with Gatsby, Yugo, Gridsum. I haven't heard of this one yet, but Jekyll, 11T. This must be Vuepress and Yugo and Next.js and Nuxt.js, which is quite a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, very extensive support of different
and also
generators.
Some big companies rely on them. Yeah, it has basically the same features as of content editing, but one thing I wanted to mention is that it has baked in support for Cloudinary, which I'm going to show you now for a second. It's basically a service where you upload your assets like photos, videos, stuff like that for your website, and they optimize your photos for web, scale it to the screen size you want for your website, and you can, how you query your images that you stored there is that you simply, you have a kind of API where you have different URL parameters where you set height, width, and other attributes. Like, you can also add filters to it. Yeah, it's really great. And it's kind of, so you don't have to store all the images on your, in your Git repository, which can get quite heavy. Yeah, and also if you want to store images in a Git repository, you will run easily into the Git repository size limits, which is, do you know it? I think it's 1 gigabyte.
So, I'm not sure. It could even be that they don't have a hard limit, but if you go crazy, they will contact you and say, like,
I think GitHub has a limit. GitHub,
okay,
limit,
yeah,
repository limit. And you also have a limit on individual files, which is kind of like 80 megabytes. I had the problem because I accidentally wanted to push a binary, like a compiled app, so I know it. Yeah. And if you want to host your assets on a different server, which is also a super optimized CDN, I think they are using Akamai. Last week we spoke about that, I think.
Yeah.
You can use this, which is really great. Yeah. I think I'm screen sharing. Am I? Yes. Yeah, we're presenting to everyone. Okay, we were there. Yeah, it just works also very good. Then another thing is Cloud Cannon. The interesting thing about it is that with the other tools, you have your content and don't see how it looks on your actual site. You just have the content. With this CMS, you have it already integrated in the layout of the site. It's basically what you see is what you get editor, like you have with Wix.com or something, but not as flexible because you still have the layouts. Yeah, it looks kind of like this. You are basically editing on the live, on a live preview of the site. Yeah.
But you don't have an account with them, right?
Yeah, it's also that you have a separated web application where you edit it and then the website gets built on in a normal way, how it's also done with Siteleaf or so, that you have everything is synced via GitHub and maybe other source providers. Yeah, it's kind of intuitive, but I haven't used it because at the point I wanted to use it, it wasn't as stable as I would have liked it to be. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it has a Git sync, how I said it. Yeah. Yeah, they also include like the publishing workflow, deployment workflow, as Siteleaf also does, but yeah. Let's look into the editing features. Yeah. It's basically a visual editor for your Jekyll layouts, which is really great because you see, you can just edit on the site that you see where every content is fit in, which you don't have with the other CMS I showed you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's kind of great, but it doesn't work great with AMP, or at least I think so, because you don't have like the normal image attributes you have here. You have AMP image as the tag, and it shouldn't work very well there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's look into one of the this is a headless CMS. It's made for very big websites. I used it for one project. It really worked, but yeah, it wasn't that easy to connect it with Jekyll, although they have a tool or a Ruby plugin for Jekyll that does it. Kind of works, but yeah. It's great for if you are developing mobile applications to use it as the content editing solution.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Great. Can we see features? Maybe they are showing us how it works. Yeah, it kind of looks the same as any of those solutions. You have an editor with your commands, heading, bold, italic, quotes, you can insert lists, links, and that's it. It's basically the same for everything, every tool. Yeah. And yeah, let's look at it. They have a GraphQL API. They also should have a REST API. And what is also great is you have webhooks where you could trigger builds.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe that's enough for Contentful. And let's maybe dive in all their pricing now.
Yes.
Siteleaf can get quite expensive, but it also has a free plan, which is for developers. You have only one user, I think, and you don't have the possibility to add any Jekyll plugins instead of the whitelisted, which are some of the most used and mainly like all the standard Jekyll plugins. Yeah. Then you have the personal plan, which is $7 per month, and then team 29, and You only get the user roles, admin, publisher, and writer with this plan. Yeah. Then 89 for business. Yeah. Yeah, what can we see the site size limits here? Here.
Maybe they have a detailed view somewhere, because
I think this is already the detailed view.
Okay.
They are only showing it in the settings of your page, what the size of your project is. I think for this is, it was someone said it earlier in the
100 pages and 100 megabytes.
Yeah, and I think I know it that the personal plan should be around 500 megabytes and maybe something like 250 pages. Team is a bit bigger. Yeah, and you have unlimited pages, which is needed for some pages. Yeah. But you can see if you have to pay 29 per month, and it's only if you pay annually, it's $36 if you pay it monthly, which is pretty not very, it could be cheaper, I think, but yeah. Mm-hmm. Then you have forestry, which starts at much more. You have the, okay, I didn't mention Siteleaf's pricing is per page. And Forestry has a different pricing, which you can see isn't limited to pages or sites. Websites, yeah. You have unlimited sites with the $29 plan. And only 3 sites with the personal plan. With Siteleaf, you can have unlimited free sites, but you have very limited features as well. Yeah. Okay. What else? Yeah, there's the pro plan. I think we don't need to talk about that a lot. Yeah. Then let's look into Cloud Cannon. Their pricing is also very interesting. Pricing. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, they have already a very good hosting included. Yeah.
Which one would you recommend? Like for the beginners?
For the beginners?
If you want to stay in the free tier.
If you just have a free blog, a personal blog that is a public repository on GitHub, just use Siteleaf. It's super easy to set up as well, and it works just very stable. Yeah.
Lucas, just by the way, I had this question in my head. I wanted to ask you. If you just would create a website, static website, just from the scratch using Siteleaf, if your repository would be completely empty on GitHub, would it work?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. So if you are not familiar with Jekyll and you kind of need time to learn it and everything, maybe it's a good starting point to create a Jekyll website. A static website generated by Jekyll using this Siteleaf.
I don't know how it will look, but you could also, I think it has the Jekyll standard template or something like this. Or maybe if you want, we could try this. Let me just stop presenting for a second. And
I mean, if you have time, we can create very bare bones website from scratch using this stack,
yeah,
this combination of tools.
I will present again your entire screen. Okay, works. Yeah, you can start from scratch here. I will call it Lucas's test site. Just grammatically incorrect. Okay. I will just get a very weird subdomain, but it should work. Yeah. It's creating a test site and we have nothing in it for now. Then
we have this structure. We have pages and we have posts, which were kind of
just the checker basic. Yeah. You see, we don't have syncing enabled and we can try to do that now. Maybe GitHub, connect with GitHub, public repositories. Yeah. Create a new repo on GitHub. They are just giving me this possibility. Lucas's test. It's a very weird name, but I don't want to get in conflicts with anything I already created. Should work. Lucas. I will just reconnect. Yeah, should work. Okay, I will enable the syncing and it. Does it already start? Yeah, we only have the config file. Does it? Yeah. So it isn't really as what we wanted to do, because we just get the content without any templates or styling. So maybe we would start differently and just initialize a plain Jekyll site and on the command line with Jekyll new or Jekyll create. I don't know how the command works exactly. Yeah, like this project, make dear. Test. Or now I can remove this test. Yeah, I will just say Jekyll. Just look for the command. It is Jekyll new. Test. And it will create a plain Jekyll site. We can go into this repository and then we have to initialize Git like you are instructed to if you are creating a new repository. And yeah, test for the typo here. Just created a new repository. Then you make this in it. I will increase the size, font size at all. Let's just copy it because it's faster. Then let's copy this. Functions M master. Then let's connect it. Then let's just push it to GitHub. Then we can just connect it as I showed you earlier. Then we can just connect it with Sideleaf. Yeah. Should also work. And now we have a very simple site Let's enable GitHub Pages to see how it looks. Save. Where do we see GitHub Pages? Yeah, it's already published, and my domain should be lucas-h.github.io/. Okay, sorry. Test. Like this. And we have our Jekyll site here, which doesn't look good because we have to change something. We have to change our base URL here to /test-test/test. Now we just save it. And after this is built, it should look better. And then we could connect it with Siteleaf as well. Yeah.
Okay, very cool.
Yes.
Are there any other topics which we have in the pipeline for today, or is it everything?
Yeah, looks better now. Just the plain Jekyll website. Yeah, I have some free alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
We also have a free content management system by Netlify. I haven't used it for a long time. I saw it like when it was in the doing and they just were starting out. And yeah, but I don't know how to host it. So maybe let's look into it. Let's just watch the video together.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, it's 2:30. Yeah, it's maybe too long to watch it. I thought it was like a quick demonstration, but it's.
Yep. Is it also a SaaS? What do you think? Or is it something what you can host yourself somewhere?
It should be self-hosted.
Because I don't see any like function to register yourself or stuff like this.
I think you have to add it to your into your. This is something I personally do not like very much. I think you have to add it to your website. So you have like your website URL /admin.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have it hosted. It's a front end and you connect it somehow to a software as a service by Netlify. Mm-hmm. I was confusing it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Netlify somehow hosted by them, but the front end is hosted by you, which is kind of a weird thing. I do not really like, but it's free. Yeah, you also have Jekyll admin, which is kind of the same, but not as elegant, which does the same. You just have to install a gem and you have to install it as a Ruby plugin to your gem file and then mention it in your config. Then you have to configure it a bit.
But it's an official extension, yeah, of Jekyll.
Yeah, somehow.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
But it's, it provides user with the traditional CMS, which is integrated into the site, which I do not really like because this way, your site gets possibly vulnerable again.
Mm. Interesting.
This is just front end based. You just have a front end there and no like back end code that runs. It's just a React or something based front end which interacts with GitHub API. I don't know if it's true, should be.
Interesting.
But I haven't used it because it was also when I started using Siteleaf, it wasn't in the state to be productively deployed. Yeah. There you can see it. It's React, Redux, Webpack, SAS. Yeah, we covered SAS in another session. Do you remember?
Yeah. I think two or three sessions ago, something like this. Any other free alternatives for CMS for Jamstack?
But there are some, but they are not very advanced.
Okay.
But you can also just do, where have I opened it? Can just do this, use GitHub as the editor. Yeah. It also works, but then you have to deal with YAML and Markdown yourself. Yeah.
Okay.
Which you cannot do for. Yeah.
And then you have to, on your computer, you have to always keep your local version updated. Like you have to fetch frequently after you change something on directly on the GitHub.
Yeah, this is true. But yeah, you could also use your IDE you have installed locally or a Markdown editor there. But it's not as comfortable as the existing tools.
Yes.
But maybe to wrap up this session, I also said I have a resource where you can find many other headless CMS. It's called headlesscms.org, which is a site by Netlify again. They have the site staticgen.com, which is a list of static.
Yes, they have these two projects, right? Like two websites, which they kind of sponsor and keep up to date. It's headless CMS, and another one is static sites or something like this.
Yeah. I mean, now you can see it headlesscms.org. Yeah, a list of content management systems for Jamstack, because they think if they like, or I think that they do these websites that they promote the Jamstack. So even if people are using other tech, like if 100 users are because of those sites using Jamstack now, maybe 30 or something are using then also Netlify. Yeah, maybe that's kind of the strategy they follow. Right. Yeah.
Just only one question here from Brooks. It was asked before that. Can you see the question, Lucas, in the chat?
Yeah, give me just a second. I'm gonna stop presenting now.
Yes.
I will then post the thing here. Yeah. Okay. He said dynamic content gets built at request time. Isn't this pretty much what WordPress does? Okay. We have the Jamstack doesn't allow I see another.
It was another question. Read the previous question and then I answered, but maybe it was not understood as I intended it.
Should I read it or would you?
What's your opinion? Like, it's definitely not similar to WordPress in many, many ways. Like, WordPress would generate, and any other traditional content management system would generate the content every time if the output of the page is not cached somewhere in between, what is really very efficient way to serve similar content. If you don't change like from one request to another one, the content, then cache it. It's very quick. Yeah. But if you don't cache, WordPress will go through the whole process of building this page every time with this kind of static sites built on Gem stack. Most of the content is static and it's like lightning. Yeah. Like
the Gem stack works as follows. Follow. You have a website where you can connect. Okay, you have a Git repository or something where your content is stored. You have a content management system which manipulates this content stored. Every time this is something is changing there, like you make a commit, a build process is started and generates, using the static site generator, a new snapshot of your site, compiles your site and then deploys it to a content delivery network. Main content for your site. If you want to add some dynamic, this should be the main content of your site. If we have, for example, our community page, we have like all the event descriptions, titles, images, those are statically generated and on the CDN. But if we want to add dynamic features to it, those aren't very critical. Those are like only an addition to what we already have statically built. Then we take microservices, which we access through APIs, and then we render them asynchronously into our web front end. So after our site with all the static content that is generated by our static site generator, after that is displayed, on the front end, a JavaScript is responsible to fetch all the data, all the dynamic data from an API or something, a microservice that we connect to it, and then render all the additional data that isn't like mission critical. Yeah. What's that?
Like, for example, if you have just a page, your personal page, your portfolio page, you can perfectly make it static. Once in a month, maybe you will need to change something on the page, then you can do it in GitHub or wherever you want. You can deploy it, and the rest of the time, people will be seeing your page in this kind of way, statically, without any generation, any content generation.
If we stick to the example I made before, we have our website which shows an event. All the event information is built statically, like title, date, description, and also the organizers. But the event registration process is dynamic data, which is just an addition to what we built statically. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
This is rendered then dynamically into the site after it is already shown on the screen. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. Some other terms for it are, I think it's lazy loading or some asynchronous strategies to show the content. Hmm. Let's just look. Are there some other questions? Today we have some more listeners. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very cool. So if there are no questions anymore, and if we are done with the session itself, I think I can share now the form for the raffle. I just shared it in the chat. Please use it for yourself only, not for your pets at home, you know, not for your friends, and don't share it anywhere, because we clearly will be raffling it off only within these members who are actually in this session. We have 17 to 19 people right now in this session. Fill out this form. You will need only to put your email address and your name, and that's pretty much it. You can rate this session. You can add any wishes for the next ones or what we can improve. We are really very eager to learn what we can do better.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if you heard it today, but we are both not completely in best shape this week because I have a bit of a cold. Yeah, but
you know, this is like probably still when the summer finishes, at least here in Germany, where we are located right now, after the summer, end of September, you know, the new wave of flu or any other illnesses is beginning. So that's the case right now. Yeah, but everyone, just stay safe in your place where you are. Yeah. Take care of yourself and your family members. Yeah. And this is one of the most important things right now.
Yeah, don't get COVID-19.
No, not COVID, not anything else. Just try to really take care of yourself. And if you are in trouble, make sure to get help.
Yeah. And if you have some questions during the week, you could also write it into the cloud community Slack, for example, or where are we else? It's on Discord as well.
Yeah, we have for discussions, we have Slack, we have Discord, and we have a Telegram group. Yeah. Whenever you will write, probably you will get quickly an answer. And if you are not there, just pick. We have different kind of platforms to have a communication going on, because people are preferring different tools, you know, and installing on their devices. And if you are not using absolutely like Slack or Discord, then go and take a Telegram client and then use our channel there and something like this. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm on Slack, by the way.
You're on Slack. Okay. Yeah. Slack is a kind of getting old a little bit already, you know. It's a it's super popular.
In many, many different communities where people kind of are switching to Discord and other solutions. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. We have 9 submissions right now. If you want to know who is the winner of this raffle, because we cannot really, we have only one item of this prize. We cannot really give it away to everyone. Unfortunately, we would love to do it, but in this case, it's just one item that we have. And if you want to know who is the winner, just stay for a couple of more minutes. We will have a spin of lucky wheel, and we'll see who will be there. But really, we will just close the form already in a few seconds. So if you haven't filled it out, and it only applies to people who are in the call, not everyone in this world, like with whom it can be theoretically shared, then fill it out. And we're about to close the form right now. We have 12 submissions right now. Okay, let's count from 5 to 1 and then close the form. 5, 4, 3, 2, one, and the form is closed now. Okay, let me take the names. Okay, I have the names right now. We have 13 people. And I'm going to share my screen. Takes a moment. I hope it will work. Like sometimes it's strange.
Yesterday I used StreamYard for an event, and there you could set a really nice countdown animation. Maybe we could do that for the next raffle.
Okay. Yeah. Huh. Strange. I kind of tried to present. It's not presenting. What I can do, and then you have to believe me that I'm not cheating or anything. I have this wheel of names, which we use in almost in every raffle. And I have 13 names. Srinivasulu, Thomas Schubert, Satish, Matan, Brooks, Pratik, Tibebes, Aban, Anand, Birkenjit, Kevin, Maxim, and Srinivasa. So basically, this 13 people, I will just go for a spin. Sorry, my screen for some reason is not sharing. I'm just going for one spin right now, and I will tell you who is the winner. And please believe me, I am not cheating. Oh, it's actually Srinivasulu Paranduru. I think it's also the first person who managed to submit the form. So very quickly, congratulations, Srinivasulu. I got your email, and you will get a special code, which you can redeem from me just in a few minutes after we finish this session here. And yeah, thank you very much for taking part. We will keep doing this kind of raffles. We will have prizes coming up, also for everyone, not just for winners. Make sure to attend our events and have fun. Ask questions. If you have anything to present, anything to share, feel free to jump on, get in touch with me, with Karen, and I will be really glad to provide you our community platform to present whatever you have on your mind, what you're working on. It was also the case with Lucas, and it applies and extends to really everyone in our community. And I'm just in the chat again. I'm sharing the name of the winner. Next time I will try to fix it to make my screen sharing, you know.
Yeah, and also that didn't work. Yeah.
What didn't work?
Your camera. So
yeah, my camera is also not working. I don't know what's going on here. Yeah. Okay, everyone. So take care and see you next time. Thank you very much, Lucas, for an amazing session again. See you next week.
Yeah. See you all.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.